and he might be hurt. Randy trying to close in though now. And he goes down. He's down. And Chuck Liddell. Oh, he is out. Chuck Liddell. Chuck into the world. Randy Couture is out.
After a few weeks of lackluster cards, or if you're going off of last week's, lackluster cards. Thank you, Blake. Thank you. I'll be here all week, unfortunately, for all you poor bastards. We're finally getting into some of the good stuff, possibly with, it looked like it was just going to be a straightforward main event with Marvin Vettori and Paulo Costa, but guess not, but we'll, of course, get into that a little later when we talk UFC Vegas 41. UFC Vegas 40, not a bad card by any means. Nothing great, but we're finally getting here. We're getting to this fight night. And after this, we get back-to-back pay-per-views with a bunch of title fights. It's going to be amazing. So sit down, buckle up, because we got some great stuff to talk about here today. Not only are we going to break down UFC Vegas 40, we're going to give you our top five fighters that are cool to hate. Colby Covington and Yoani and Jacek have some choice words, and like I said, a little bit of controversy going down with the main event of UFC Vegas 41. But of course, I'm your host, Ross Allen, joined alongside by the fourth long UFC correspondent, Blake Campbell. And Blake, how are we feeling after this good weekend of fights? And let's just talk about Saturday, not focus on Sunday at all, please.
I'm feeling pretty good. Besides, you know, actually watching the fights, it wasn't the best, but, can't complain. As long as there's fights on and as long as people are throwing punches, I'm pretty happy.
Exactly. There's some good stuff. I mean, technically every card's for free, you know,
I mean, really Jim Miller kind of put the show on his back with that freaking finish, but,
Jim Miller is a savage.
Because, you know, someone I was really looking forward to, just to kind of tail off on that, yeah, was Fiorro.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, she did have a good performance. She won. But I think there was a few times, I forget who was on commentating. Was it Bisping? Who the heck was commentating this weekend?
Bisping was on there.
Yeah, I mean, they were just pointing out, like, she was just throwing the same combination over and over, mm-hmm, and over and over and over. And it's like, dude, that's on tape. People are going to be prepared for that next fight. Mm-hmm. So hopefully she cleans some things up, and I don't know, maybe it was just the game plan she had for that specific fighter, but I was, mm-hmm, expecting a lot more from her. Mm. Still, like I said, though, dominated the fight for the most part. I mean, really, like, the other girl was, she was really good at talking crap and making faces, but she wasn't very good at fighting.
Yeah, that really was about it. Blake, already ready to get into the analysis of this card. I love it. But ladies and gentlemen, thank you so we're ready. We're always, I mean, Blake, you should have seen Blake before the show, always ready. Even that ugly Sugar Sean hoodie, okay? Probably, is it made out of hemp?
It's made out of, weed follicles.
Yeah, is it actually? Because I was saying that'd be smart. Oh, okay. No. Well, that would be smart. You kind of expect that from Sean, but
that'd be a sweet collab.
It makes sense, man. Hey, but thank you so much for joining us here today on UFC Talk 62. Oh, we're 7 away, Blake. We're 7 away. We're going to get there. Oh, man. But thank you all so much for joining. Of course, you can catch all of our content over at thefourthandlong.com. Find us on our socials, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you can find the show. We are there. And also, for all your MMA relay content, The Fourth and Long, check out thefourthandlong.com/MMA. And Blake, like I've been saying, we have some huge news. Is that, you know, we've had the NFL merch. We've had the normal Fourth and Long merch. We've had the AFL merch. You want to know what we haven't had yet? We haven't any MMA merch. And so that's why I've recently dropped the Certified Banger Collection. Of course, if you're watching on video, you can see this sexy shirt right here. Oh, yeah. It's looking good. It's tri-blend. It's cotton. It's that good stuff. And also, it hugs your arms pretty well. And so I'm a huge fan. And they don't really shrink in the dryer, too, which is a big plus. Don't have to hang dry these suckers, okay? So go on over to thefourthlong.com/apparel to go grab one of these t-shirts or hoodies today, because you will not regret it. And one more plug before we hop into things fully is that two recent interviews with Raymond Lawley and Jared Melton, two guys that they're going to have some championship gold around their waist here in about 2 years. They have fights with a local fight promotion up here in Idaho, Front Street Fights. They're both taking on some young up-and-comers like themselves, but all I can tell you is that these two dudes are some bad mothers, and they're going to put some people's lights out. So go ahead, make sure to check out those interviews right now. Of course, you can find that at thefourthlong.com/MMA, because you're going to want to know who these guys are before they get big. Guaranteed. But Blake, let's get into things. UFC Vegas 40. Did the bangers hit?
Not really.
I'll give you the first one at least. For sure.
Yeah, I mean, the first one, I called that one.
With Patrick Allen Davis? That was...
Yeah.
Ooh, boy. Good.
Told you that dude's a problem.
Wasn't long.
That's super exciting for the bantamweight division. Already filled with sharks, you know. So this guy, he's just a phenom. Just round one KOs over and over and over, consistent. So I mean, now it's time for maybe a little step up in competition already.
Mm-hmm. Love that. And then I mean, to be fair, Arlovski and Felipe was a pretty solid fight too. I was entertained.
It was decent. The first round was a little lackluster for my taste. Mm. But yeah, definitely Felipe started picking it up towards the second and third round. And he actually did, I think it was in the third round,
wobbled
Arlovski. Yeah. So there was some moments in that fight. But I mean, I was expecting a little bit more from Felipe. I thought he usually has a little bit more dog in him. I mean, he was definitely talking trash.
Yeah, Arlovski is just that guy, man. Pitbulls.
Yeah.
Talk about two guys that are just savvy eternal. Vet. In the UFC, with Orlovsky and Miller on the same card. Also, two dudes with some pretty good nicknames, with Pitbull and A-10. It's good stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Then the last one here. I mean, with Fiorio and Silva, if we actually just want to talk about this, kind of leads into one of my winners here of the night. One of my three is Manon Fiora and... Now, Blake kind of alluded to this, you know, here in the intro, is that it wasn't necessarily the fight we were expecting from her, but it wasn't a bad one by any means. It was, I mean, fairly one-dimensional, throwing one kind of combo, but, hey, she has her fundamentals down, which is always good. It didn't help that her opponent couldn't stop the same combo being thrown for 15 minutes. Almost got the finish in certain parts of this, but not quite, but still, yet another dominant performance for her, and she moves right up the rankings. And I mean, one of the fighters that we talked about last week in this division, in Maria Agapova. I don't think it'd be smart to match these two up together, because you're probably going to be pushing these two as the next challengers to Shevchenko. But both these women look like they might be contenders, and honestly, if they were to fight each other, I think that'd be pretty damn good. What do you think about
absolutely.
This? What do you think about Fiora's kind of position in the division? And does, like, there's a lot of people almost wanting her to fight Shevchenko already. I'm not buying into that, though. Are you?
No. I mean, she just fought. I mean, could you, if you weren't looking directly at the fight card, could you tell me who she fought?
Nope. And she's kind of Sean O'Malley fighting the cans a little bit, too.
And I mean, I guess that's kind of a crappy thing to say.
It's true, though. It's true.
But you do need to have a little bit of hype. I mean, the UFC is a little bit of a hype machine. It is, you need to have good talents. You need to have good performances. But you do need to have a little bit of hype and a little bit of, what have you done for me lately?
Mm-hmm.
And Fiora, while she's had some decent win, I mean, two KO wins and then a pretty dominant decision win against Silva.
Yep.
I mean, what's crazy though, is if you look at the numbers, they're not as, They're not as off as I thought they were going to be. I mean, she only
the visual looked a lot different than the actual stat sheet, which I think is what's more important anyway, especially to judges. because they don't get to see the stats like we do.
Definitely.
At least that's what we're told.
Yeah, you never know. You never know what they're writing down over there.
Right.
But yeah, for this specific fighter, Fioro, I would like to see her get another step up in competition. Maybe
ranked fighter time.
Yeah, give her someone in the rankings. I don't know, Lauren Murphy that just came off of a title defense. Miranda Maverick. Mm. I think Calvillo just got matched up. I mean, I think Andrade is probably going back to 115.
Yeah, I wish Macy Barber Chukagian. Would be great, but she already has a fight matchup. Chukagian
would be a sweet fight.
Grasso
would be another good fight. That's going to be another contender up there for sure.
If you want to throw, I mean, Roxanne Modafferi, good vet for either Fiora Macy or Barber. Or I think she already has a fight right now. She stepped in.
She does have a fight, but these are all names. Shit, I'd have to check that.
Yeah.
I think it is.
Yeah.
I think it is actually.
Step in there with there. So those
the
are
from, the one from Australia. Is she from Australia or from New Zealand?
She's from Oceania.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, let's leave it at that. But there's a lot of really good fights for her next, though. And I love a Miranda Maverick. You know, taking a step in number 15 right there.
I don't think she is fighting Casey O'Neill.
Oh, Macy, I know I remember seeing Macy Barber's find someone. Excuse me for not remembering exactly who.
Yeah, because I'm looking at an article right now saying that she wanted to take it and she would have took it in February if Barber wanted to wait. But
that's right. Barber's fighting Aaron Blanchfield at 269.
Yeah, and she was actually going after Montana De La Rosa first. And then Blanchfield stepped in.
I respect her trying to go for that, even though her last fight wasn't necessarily a win.
It was technically a win.
Well, it's a win in the record books, that's for sure. Now, next person, I mean, you also spoke about him too. Jim frickin' Miller, man. This guy now has the most fights in UFC history. And he's only like a couple knockouts behind Don Cerrone for the most knockouts in UFC history. And this was his first KO since 2016, if you would believe that. Everything else has been submissions or decisions as well. And, dude, he just looks so good. And it's insane to think about, man, that's been fighting for so long. It's still a solid fighter and still able to put on great performances. And you gotta love the call outs he made after the fight. Not only did he I would love this, the rematch with Don Cerrone, I think it's from 2014. I would have zero complaints with that. I mean, no one would have any complaints about that one. Or better yet, calling out Dustin Poirier, Charles Oliveira, and Conor McGregor at the same time, all three at the same time. I love it. And honestly, I would like to see that. And Blake, honestly, four guys, one octagon. Who comes out of that last?
Wait, what were the four fighters again? I'm so sorry.
Miller called out Poirier, McGregor, and Oliveira to fight all at the same time.
There's only one guy coming out alive.
Four men enter, one man leaves.
Quadruple threat match.
Yes.
Like
one of those Thermopylae fights, man.
I think they're all going to gang up on McGregor first.
Just to whoop his ass.
Probably just fuck him up really quick. And then they'll probably take out, you know, Oliveira because he's got the title. And then it'll be Miller versus Poirier. And Poirier's already won that fight, so Poirier probably will win.
Fair enough. But Miller makes it to the second last two.
Yeah, absolutely.
Ooh, I love that.
No.
Hey, what? I guarantee there has to be some sort of backyard Russian promotion that does stuff like this already. Has to be. I remember seeing those, like, it's like 5-on-5 at one time. Sometimes they have those. Or a really underground, I don't even know if they're still running because I haven't checked out on them in a little bit, but Thermopylae. It's like this Russian MMA promotion where it's like a ring that's super long and skinny, and you got two teams of five, and essentially it's last team standing. Like, they pair one guy up in this kind of real thin rectangle.
But if you beat your guy, can you go help out one of your boys?
Oh, no. It's just one fight at the same time. So it's like the four are just in the corner, and then the two, then one from each team is fighting in the middle.
Oh, and then okay. So they'll not fight. All fighting simultaneously.
Yeah, so it's almost like King of the Hill. So like the whoever wins stays in for the next guy from the other team, and it's like elimination style. It's kind of wild.
That's crazy. What if one guy just wiped out all five of their guys?
That's happened. I've seen it. This is one of those things when last summer when there wasn't really a whole lot going down. This is one of the sports I got into. Well, I wasn't watching live, just watching a bunch of old videos on YouTube, and I was entertained. Go check it out. It's called Thermopylae, like Thermopylae Fight Club, or it's something like that. It's interesting. Jim Miller, breaking news: Jim Miller to Thermopylae FC. That's happening. And the last person I got to talk about here is the winner of the main event, not by decision, but by demolition. And that is Norma Dumont, and she likely just earned herself a featherweight title shot against Amanda Nunes. And she just outclassed and outworked Aspen Ladd for 25 minutes here. We're going to talk about Aspen Ladd here in a second, but your thoughts on Dumont and her performance, and is she a legit contender to Amanda Nunes' title? No, but is she a more legit contender than maybe the likes of Megan Anderson?
No. I mean, so that's to the first question. Mm-hmm. Is she a legit contender? Is she going to actually challenge Amanda Nunes? No.
Is she going to be a better challenge than some of the other 145ers?
She beat Felicia Spencer, didn't she?
Yeah.
So, I mean, maybe minutely she could be
marginally
a percentage better, but it's like
she'll make it out of the first round.
From what I've seen in that Aspen Ladd fight, it's like, what? I don't know. I wasn't really impressed by anything. Mm-hmm. I mean, she was pretty much unscathed for the most part until the last round. I think she got her nose busted a little bit in the last round.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's 25 minutes of fighting, though. Like, I'd be surprised if you don't have something on you.
It's going to happen.
But it really was just a jab and takedown defense for her, you know, and then just keeping everything, mm-hmm. you know, out in space. Cause she had, I want to say like a 2 or 3 inch reach advantage. And she was utilizing her jab really well. But I mean, how often did you see a sweet combination from her? Maybe like 2 or 3 times in the whole mm-hmm. fight where she strung together more than one or two punches.
They happen too often.
But I mean, every fight's different. Every fighter is going to present different challenges mm-hmm. and you're going to have a different game plan going into every fight. So this was really my first time paying super close attention to Dumont.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't the first for Aspen Ladd. Before this, no. I had a really, I held Aspen Ladd in pretty high regards. I thought she was one of the elite for the women.
Mm-hmm.
But after that fight, it just seems like she's really regressed and maybe doesn't fully trust, you know, everything in her body yet. I don't know what it could have been because she just looks so flat.
It wasn't. Like she didn't look bad physically. It just looked like she did not want to be there. I really think this is mostly I mean, obviously we're just speculating because I don't know what the hell is going on with her. But it looks like a mental thing. It really does. And remember when she was fighting her last fight, December 7th on 2019 there. When she ended up KOing Yana Kunitsuka. Kaya, I probably just butchered the hell out of that name, but you know it is what it is. Thiago Santos gonna kill me for that. Please don't though. She wasn't doing jack for the first 2 rounds, and she comes out, gets a really good talk to her by Coach Jim West, and gets knocked out 33 seconds into that 5th round. Now in this fight, kind of got the same Stern talking to for 4 rounds, and she didn't really make any changes. And there's a lot of people, I mean, I guess enough people where Jim West, the Aspen Ladd's coach, came out and felt the need to have to apologize for his actions during this fight in terms of his coaching style in this one. And I think that's absurd that he had to do that. You know, it really wasn't that bad. We've seen worse. And it's not like he was being mean to her. He's just being honest. And that's what a good coach does. We've seen too many coaches that go like, yeah, you're up. When no, you're not, you know?
When I think guys with big platforms get to push a certain narrative out and a lot of people are going to follow that narrative.
Mm.
It gives people stuff to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
If they really were listening and watching the whole fight and didn't just react off of a 1 minute clip that they saw Jed Goldman or whatever repost and an aerial retweet,
mm-hmm.
they're not going to have that same, I think, thought go through their mind. Because when I was watching that in real time, I thought to myself like, oh damn, like he's being real with her.
Yeah.
Like that's what you need to hear sometimes. People don't understand that. I mean, I've never played professional sports, but I've had a coach get after me like 20 times worse than that.
Yeah.
And,
honestly, all the times, remember,
that helps.
See, but I'm not sure how much I know you weren't really too much of a football guy. Obviously that was my main sport.
I mean, a very big football guy. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah. Playing the worst high school sport you ever could.
Whatever. Even
more boring than baseball. But
okay, come on. Let's most of the population in the world would disagree with you on that.
But literally most of the population in the world, I don't care. Okay, so.
Yeah, well, you just lost 10,000 subscribers right there.
I wish I had 10,000 subscribers to lose, Blake.
Because you don't like football. Speaking of which, go subscribe
on YouTube. And that's one of the rules, but we won't. If you don't like soccer, don't worry. We never talk about it here. We talk two types of football, and that's it. But going back to what I was saying, there's always those times where you've had a coach just grab your face mask and start spitting in your face angry. That happens, man. It just happens. One of my favorite things.
Sounds a little sus.
You need to stop.
You had a grown man spitting in your face, bro?
Okay, you play with balls.
You play with balls.
No, I was a lineman.
Oval balls,
dude,
bro.
I was a lineman, man. I never touched a ball.
Yeah, you're hugging dudes all game.
No.
Yeah, you're hugging dudes, I'm laying on top.
No,
you're like
I am angrily hugging dudes all game, okay? Don't even get me started. One of my favorite coaches, he went word for word. I won't say it all the time because I want to drop the F-bomb too many times, I guess, because I like to use it sparingly, at least on this. In real life, ooh, a little bit of a different story there. But he went, and I quote, "What the effing are you effing doing out there?" And it was one of the greatest things I've ever heard. It was one of those times, you know, I was with the rest of another part of my group there, and we're all on the sideline really trying not to laugh because if he saw us laughing, we get our asses chewed out too. But it's one of those moments. I'm sure you know those. Where you see a dude mess up that bad and try not to laugh because you get in trouble too. Mm. But I think the main thing here is that I don't know how many people have heard this, but it's fact. And that is, if a coach is yelling at you, that means they care and that means they want you to get better. The moment that a coach stops yelling at you or stops disciplining you, that means that they don't care, and that's the moment that they don't care about your future. I think it's simple as that. If your coach is yelling at you like this, they care about you. Now, and not everyone might agree with your coaching techniques, but this is not out of, well, I mean, I'm sure a lot of it out of anger and frustration, but this is all just to get your fighter better. And there is nothing wrong with that.
I saw a comment yesterday too that said, I saw a lot of people going after the coach for not providing good coaching advice, but it's like, man, when you have your fighter in there for 15-ish minutes and she hasn't even started the fight, what are you going to say to her?
Yeah.
There's nothing you can correct.
Yeah.
There's nothing you can point to and be like, hey, do this a little different. Do that a little different.
You're not doing anything.
The only thing you can say is just get into a fight. Like,
how are you going to do nothing differently?
Yeah. So, I mean, there really was no chance for technical advice mm-hmm. when she completely just wasn't engaging.
Yeah. It was a bad fight for Aspen.
He didn't say anything insulting. He didn't say anything really, in my opinion, demeaning.
He didn't probably say anything wrong.
Probably the most demeaning thing he said was he called the other girl a broad, you know, like you need to go out there and start hitting this broad or whatever he said. But I mean, other than that, he's just trying to light a fire under her butt, you know, and really get her to be, you know, turn that savage mode on, because I don't think we ever saw that with Aspen Ladd. And in every other fight, for the most part, we've seen her savage mode. Mm-hmm. She gets freaking crazy in there, you know.
It's been a while.
Throws with determination.
I miss it because she looked damn good. She looked like a contender during that. I think I still think she has promise and potential. just kind of to go back to the drawing board and then and figure out for the next fight there. But those are our thoughts on UFC Vegas 40. We're going to keep things rolling into our cool to hate list. And before we get that, of course, make sure to check us out over on YouTube. And that's Fourth and Long Radio. Drop a subscribe if you haven't yet. And go make sure you check us out on our socials. At Twitter is at Fourth and Long Radio. And Instagram is at Fourth and Long Radio. Of course, you can find all of our stuff at thefourthandlong.com. But essentially what this list is, cool to hate. So we have our top five fighters that we say is, it's the cool thing to hate them. And we did rank them respectively here as well. There's a lot of guys that really could make this list, whether OGs or current ones, some recently retired fighters as well. And so, Blake, we're going to go into this. So go ahead, give me the first guy on your list here. Who is cool to hate?
All the cool kids like to hate on John Jones.
I don't know, it's kind of warranted recently.
I mean, enough said. It's women. It's
pregnant women.
Does hit and runs, breaks laws.
Hiding underneath octagons to avoid USADA.
Drug cheat. Takes dick pills. It's just not a good look, man. It's pretty easy to hate on the guy.
And I think in that same sense too with John Jones is I think the guy number five on my list here is Daniel Cormier. A lot of people like to clown on him for crying after that loss to John Jones. Some people even clown him for his reaction to when he found out that John Jones popped and that they weren't going to fight. I mean, we all remember that. Now Daniel Cormier, he's one of the if he beat Stipe Miocic in that trilogy, he'd be known as the greatest heavyweight fighter of all time. Right now, he is one of the greatest fighters of all time. He's a freaking Olympian, okay? He's damn good. Also, fantastic commentator as well. Fantastic commentator. But with the memes, with the fat jokes, it's all low-hanging fruit. It's all right there. And I mean, I've done it too. But he's a real easy guy to hate, but I think he's one of my favorite guys, like favorite personalities in MMA right now.
He's an easy guy to root for.
Yeah.
He's an easy guy to hate, but he's also an easy guy to root for. I think
it's funny.
He's one of those guys just similar to another guy that I'm going to bring up in my list in a little bit.
Okay.
Where the tides have kind of turned in current days.
Ah.
Where people I think are starting to see, this guy isn't so bad. He at least he's insightful and shares his opinions thoughtfully and carefully.
I think I know who you might be talking about there, but of course we'll get that in a minute. I'll give my number four guy. We'll bounce back to you. Now, my number four guy that's easy, that's cool to hate is Brock Lesnar. Because, we can't deny it. This guy was freaking fun to watch because he's just big, massive dude with big old muscles and a sword on his chest. Okay, he had a sword on his chest, but also he... His voice doesn't match how he looks. And there's a lot of people just call him overrated and overhyped. He had a couple title defenses in there when the UFC heavyweight division really wasn't too great. Then he got rolled over in his last couple fights there. But he's a really easy guy to kind of poke fun of and kind of he left the UFC for wrestling and stuff like that. Or, I mean, really, he went wrestling, then UFC, then wrestling. Also, he had a stint with the Vikings, too, and wearing number 69. So that was great. Nice. Wore the 69 before the great Jared Allen did. So, who's really the one pushing boundaries there? But but honestly, I enjoyed fighting him. And you have to know, like, especially, can you see me now? When that line hit that UFC 200 promo, shit hit the floor, man. That's still one of my favorite promo moments of all time. It's easily up there with the best.
That's a pretty good choice. Pretty good choice. Definitely was hated on back in the day. And I mean, even as recent as, when he got in the cage with Daniel Cormier and gave him that little push.
Honestly, I love that, man. That was good.
Like most MMA community rallied around DC in that situation too. So that's pretty cool to see.
Well, it's mostly who do you hate the least there, or who do you make fun of the least in that one? So who's number four on your list?
Number four for the boy, You know, since I already just alluded to it, let's just get it off the list. Keep you guys, you know, from waiting too long. I was going to go with the Dan Henderson first fight, Michael Bisping era.
The Count. Okay.
The Count. Fresh off of the Ultimate Fighter. It was too easy because it was kind of built as like America versus, you know, UK.
Come on, and you so always don't have that as going to go. I mean,
yeah, you kind of have the nationalities, you know, both guys brewing hatred towards each other's countries and all that stuff. When you bring in countries, it gets serious.
You not realize what you just did? The hatred?
Absolutely. H-bomb. Yeah. The hatred. I mean, bomb. I get that. That goes hand in hand. Dan definitely hated Michael Bisping.
Yeah, he did.
But yeah, I mean, it was, and that was what's funny is I want to say that was UFC 100. That was when I was really first kind of being introduced to the UFC. Mm-hmm. And I just remember like the biggest takeaway I had from that night was like, damn, I want Michael Bisping to get his ass beat. I don't like that Brit, you know, Revolutionary War. We won. We're about to whip your ass again.
It worked so well every time, man. And I am all for the whole, you know, America versus or nationality versus nationality, man. I love that in my sports, in especially in the UFC.
It's easy to get behind, you know.
It's so easy. It's like, oh, he's American. I'm American. Go him.
Yep. And the other guy is like freaking Russian or something. You're like, yeah, screw Russia.
Stupid Russia. So we throw it back to why the Rocky movies were so good there. And then who's number three then?
Let's do something easy. We'll do the Cringe King, the King of Cringe, Triple C, Henry Cejudo.
Soon to be Quadruple C.
It was really, I mean, it was kind of random, his whole, like, kind of rise to infamy, I guess. Yeah. I don't know if you could really say fame. I'm sure he has made some decent money, but for the most part of his career, even when he was known as, what was it, the Messenger? What the hell was he used to be known as?
Yeah, right.
You know, he used to catch a lot of heat after getting that, I believe DJ knocked him out with a knee or something, right? Mm-hmm. It was something crazy. And then he also got beat by Joey B.
Mm-hmm. That's not a bad loss.
So not saying he didn't used to get hated on, because I do remember the days definitely on Twitter back then he was getting hated on. Definitely. But also, when was it? Like 2018, maybe 2017, when he started doing the King of Cringe?
I love it. Dude, I love
and
it
then
so
that
much.
That's when it just took an absolute turn, but it picked up a lot of steam.
He went from then he had, I mean, a guy that's calling out Valentin Shevchenko to get a intergender championship.
The stuff he does is freaking great, though, dude. You can't like.
Do you see his pose with Figueiredo? That little picture where he's posing with Figueiredo, when him in the front, the two guys behind them.
I just don't. Do you see how many pillows he has made of people's faces?
So many.
I just want to see
the snake out for TJ.
Yeah, that was great. And just slams it on the freaking floor.
That was awful, but amazing. So good.
That's not awful. That's fantastic.
It's perfect, Seth. That's exactly the kind of silliness I want in my MMA for sure. For me, number three, it's going to actually be Tyron Woodley, because recently, like over the last couple of years, oh boy, your material to make fun of him is endless. I mean, from tattoo controversy after losing
Jake Paul in general,
that whole scenario with Jake Paul in general, how he just looked awful in his last number of fights with the UFC, got his rib broken against Colby Covington.
You got to remember too, he caught a lot of heat while he was champion.
Yes.
The Stephen Thompson draws, or the draw, and then him barely winning the next fight. Mm-hmm. The Damian Maya fight when he was cheating, grabbing the fence.
Yeah. His rap career.
Yeah. Usman dominating him. Till was really like the only dominating fight that he had as a title holder. I'd have to look back.
I don't think he doesn't deserve the flack that he necessarily gets. I think he deserves a little bit more respect. I mean, one of the in terms of championship and championship defense is one of the best welterweights of all time. But it's also so easy to hate him. It's so easy.
I mean, just listen to his, you know, rap music.
Listen, if you want to hate him, listen to his rap music while watching him lose to Jake Paul.
I'll beat your ass.
It's so bad.
That's like, that's actually his only like decent little. I actually kind of like that. As
that's
a joke.
All he has going for
like,
him.
Like, I would play that song before I was getting into a fight for sure. I'll beat your ass.
it's not
I'll
great.
Beat your ass.
Dude, and speak of the welterweights there too, my number two guy is going to be Leon Edwards. And I will preface this by saying, yes, I am in the category of people that I don't, I can't tell exactly why I don't like him, but I don't. I mean, he skipped out on some fights.
Three piece of soda.
That's good stuff there. He skipped, and like, you can make the claim that, yeah, he skipped out a couple fights and it has been great, but he's put on good fights for the most part. He's on one hell of a winning streak. And if he beats Jorge Masvidal, he should probably get a title shot here. But also with like, there's a lot of stuff on him. And also, he's British. So it's even easier to hate him too. It's just facts.
Ooh, there go the UK fans.
I have more Irish fans than I do British fans, so I feel like I'm going to gain more of the Irish fans there.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going for you guys. I love you guys. Yeah, Conor McGregor and potatoes. Oh, honestly, I'm in Idaho, man. I love potatoes just as much as Irish do. It's good. But Blake, you're number two.
My number two, drum roll, please. Let me look at my phone. It is.
Wait, why am I doing drum roll for number two? Shouldn't we be saving that for number one?
You do drum roll for all my picks.
No, you don't get that.
Paulo Costa.
Oh, boy. We're going to have to get into this a little bit more when we talk UFC Vegas 41. That's for sure.
Yeah, I mean.
From wine drunk?
From wine drunk the night before a fight / morning of to now coming in overweight and not really caring about it. And then saying Vittori is scared to fight. There's so many things. So many things. I mean, he got dry humped by Adesanya. There's just so many things. I could just keep going on and on and on about this guy. But you guys probably don't want to hear that. So
yeah. And now I'll give you the drum roll for number one.
Oh, for my number one? We're going to go two in a row for me?
Yeah.
All right, my number one is, I mean, it should be pretty freaking clear. Colby Covington.
Ah, there it is.
And, you know, the thing is I personally don't hate Colby Covington as much as I feel like a lot. And I think you're on the same page as me as well.
I am entertained. In the same way with Cejudo, I am entertained by Colby Covington.
Because we are able to separate the fighter, right? The fighter's over here. The gimmick is over here. Mm-hmm. And then they got a mesh, right? Yes. But you got to be able to separate them and realize, hey, this guy is really freaking talented. Mm-hmm. He wasn't getting the exposure and the coverage that he needed to do. So he figured out a way to get it.
Now he's in the news all the time.
Chael Sonnen. Like, I mean, look at these guys that are coming out now. Sugar Sean, all these Conor McGregor, Nate Diaz, like Jorge Masvidal. They're all creating these personas almost to kind of drive them to have more interest, right? Like,
Covington
like for the viewers to have more interest
with the president if it wasn't for this gimmick.
No, probably not.
Absolutely not. And honestly, one of the best choices of fighters ever done. Like, I love when Colby Covington came out to Kurt Angle's theme music to get the "You Suck" chance.
That was a good one.
That's perfect, man. That's good marketing.
Played right into it. Yeah.
And everyone ate out. Arena's full entire arena's doing the "You Suck" chants. He had people eating out of his hand. And that's a move, man. That's a baller move. That's exactly what I wanted. So I love that. And Colby Covington is that for me. And my number one guy is, maybe speaking of you Irish people, it's probably most of his haters are Irish, and that is Khabib Nurmagomedov. This is a guy, to me, that's pretty easy to hate. It's really easy to pick apart his record, his kind of strength of opponents. A lot of people, it's really easy to hate on. I guess he says some controversial stuff about some woman, and not everyone's been on board with those statements. I think that's a diplomatic way of putting that.
Well, was it a... Is it a new thing he said, or is
no, the whole same ring girl stuff.
The ring girl
same
okay,
stuff, but they dragged that story out for months because that's what we do nowadays. But
yeah,
it's also to calm a really boring fighter and to not care what he does. And because, but man, and also, I mean, Ireland hates him. That's just a fact.
Yep. I mean, but
I really don't know who Ireland hates more, Khabib or Margaret Thatcher?
It's tough when you're going It's tough, you know. I think Dustin Poirier is really the only guy that has been able to navigate so far, you know, that crowd noise going against him or now for him. Because he kind of turned it around that third fight. It really seemed like Dustin might have had more support than Conor going into it.
Yeah.
I mean, just going against Conor in general, you're going to become a villain.
Up until now. Unless the villain is Conor McGregor and Conor McGregor's doing that on purpose.
Yeah. I mean, but that's – who knows? Who knows at this point, you know?
Hey, I love it, though. For you, play, of course, John Jones, Michael Bisping, Paulo Costa, Henry Cejudo, and Colby Covington. For me, Daniel Cormier, Brock Lesnar, Tyron Woodley, Leon Edwards, and Khabib Nurmagomedov. Of course, please drop your who you think is the easiest fighter to hate and what you think about our list. Drop that in YouTube comments. Drop that over on our socials. Hit us up at Twitter and Instagram. Of course, find all of our stuff at thefourthandlong.com. Or best of all, you can leave a 5-star review over on Apple Podcasts with the fighter that you think is the easiest to hate the most. But a couple more things before I get into UFC Vegas 41 here. First off, Colby Covington has kind of came out and talked a little bit about the upcoming fight in rematch with Kamaru Usman. And he says that Marty Fake Newsman only accepted the fight because the UFC threatened to strip him. Now we just got done talking about his character and his gimmick. This is a lie, right? This has to be made up. Or do you actually think there's a little bit of truth to it?
I don't know. This is a tough one for me.
I could see it.
I could see there being some truth to it, but I do also think I don't think Usman's like that. I think if his management team and the UFC were talking about options and they came over and said, here, you know, they really are looking at this Colby Covington fight, I think that's all they would have had to say. I think Usman isn't one of those guys that's gonna be like, no, I don't fight that guy. He might say it to the media to create some buzz, but I think at the core of, you know, of himself, I think he knows who is going to be right now at this current moment the toughest challenge, and I'm sure he wants to put to bed any doubt that people have in their minds whatsoever. You know, he probably wants to end this chapter once and for all, because if he goes out there and beats Colby again, never have to see that clown ever again in his life. And exactly. He's basically his daddy. So
no, there ain't no basically about it. I am your father. I mean, dude, I'm so excited for this fight because there's a lot on the line in this one. Kamaru Usman has potentially become the greatest welterweight fighter of all time.
Still hasn't lost.
Yeah. And Colby Covington has the ability to grab the belt and pull off a giant upset. Well, I guess it wouldn't be a giant upset, but a legitimate upset here. And kind of turn the welterweight division on its head. And it's tough because I obviously we'll talk about this more once UFC 268 rolls around. But I almost want Colby Covington to win just because the world will explode. And I love chaos. you see what I did there?
Wow.
Oh, you like that? You
came
like
prepared today, huh, bud?
No, it's all top of the head. I'm just a genius. Okay. Tyron Woodley, hit me up if you need someone to write some songs for you. If you need a ghostwriter, I'll be here for you.
Don't hit him up, Tyron.
Come on, I can't be that much worse.
Ah, beat your ass.
Oh man. And speaking about that, I mean, someone that at least throughout her career is beat that ass. Let's talk about Joanna Jędrzejczyk. Is she kind of fires back at some of the critics and a lot of the fighters kind of calling out her position in the rankings, which of course is she's still ranked number two, even though she hasn't fought for about a year and a half at this point. And she doesn't really have any plans of coming back soon. But she said that she knows her worth and that anyone's welcome to take her spot in the rankings. What do you think about this, man? I'm touring Joanna because obviously I love any time she's in the octagon. Because her last fight was only the greatest woman's fight of all time, and she is the strawweight queen. But I'm kind of getting annoyed, man. I kind of just want to get to the point. If it's taking this long, just fight. Yeah, Marina Rodriguez.
Please. I don't know what's happening behind the scenes. Really couldn't tell you. That's just all speculation.
Of course.
But I mean, did anyone watch the Zhang Weili fight? That's why she's ranked number two.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, who would you put above her? Carla Esparza, a girl she sort of beat the fuck out of? Get real.
Yeah.
So I got to save those idiots and clowns out there. Like, just shut up, sit on your thumb, do something fucking crazy because you're stupid.
The people
wipe the paint off your face. Seriously. I
mean, look,
get a rag, get it wet, and then wipe your whole face off. Okay? Because you're being a clown.
Yep.
Yoani Jung Jacek would beat the shit out of every single girl in that division besides Rose and Weili.
Maybe Marina Rodriguez, but I know that'd be
a barn burner
of a fight. And that's the fight that needs to be made. But the only people above Joanna is Weili and Nama Yunus, two people that she's lost to.
Sounds very reasonable to me.
It's not bad. Like,
sounds very reasonable.
Her ranking makes sense.
Yeah, isn't that crazy? Jeez.
Clown world.
Next question.
Damn,
that pissed me off.
Let's bring the energy into UFC Vegas 41 then, because let's get into things, Blake, because this is not a bad card. I mean, it's one of those other things where the undercard isn't too bad. Don't want to step on your toes so we can get to the Blake's Bangers, but there's a few ones on here. I mean, there's
some diamonds in the rough, you know?
Davey Grant's not bad. Tabitha Ricci right there. Mason Jones.
Yeah.
Kama Worthy. I mean, there's some good stuff here. But, I mean, speaking of good stuff, Blake, Blake's Bangers time. Give it to us. What fights are guaranteed to hit this weekend?
Okay, so the bangers. We're going to do Alex Caceres. We're going to do Alex Caceres. I'm not. That was just a random.
I don't know what that was.
Just a random one. Wasn't really anything.
All right, let's move past it.
The Blake special. Alex Caceres versus Choi Sung-woo. It's going to be fire. I'm telling you right now. It's going to be stand-up war. It's going to be interesting to see.
Alex Caceres is exciting on the feet.
Yeah. And really, it's pretty easy for the bangers this week. We're just going right there in a row.
Love it.
Next fight is going to be Jessica Rose Clark versus Jocelyn Edwards. I don't know if you guys watched Jessica Rose Clark's last fight, but she looked like an absolute savage. She was just basically painting the octagon canvas with the other human being's blood. Knees, elbows, fists, kicks, didn't matter. She really looked like she put it all together. She's coming off of a major injury, so I'm very intrigued to see how she looks coming back. Fighting a fighter, fighting a woman that is actually a little bit bigger than her, 3 inches taller, going to have a 5.5-inch reach deficit. And the girl that she's fighting actually, I think she usually fights at 135, Jocelyn. So it's going to be a very interesting fight for her to come back to. But if she looks anything like she did in her most recent fight, I think it's going to be phenomenal.
Love it.
For my last pick of the bangers this week, we're going to go with a huge up-and-comer, Grant Dawson, who I believe out of his last three fights has got two finishes. And I think one might have been submission, one might have been KO, if I'm not mistaken.
You're not mistaken.
And it was against decent opponents too, with Derek Minner, Leonardo Santos. He also beat another guy that I've never heard of. So, I mean, cool for that.
Yep.
and he's going against Glenn. I don't know anything about this dude, to be honest with you. The guys he's fought, they're pretty decent here and there. But the guys that are decent that he's fought, he's usually lost to. So I'm expecting a pretty big beatdown. But I mean, sometimes beatdowns are fun to watch. Yeah. So
I mean, we all love Sugar Sean O'Malley.
You know,
beatdown. I'm excited though. I'm pretty big. I've been big on for like the last year on Grant Dawson. I think he's gonna be a force, man. I really think he's gonna be a force in the lightweight division. It's a stacked division, but the UFC's kind of done a good thing here. They haven't really pushed him too hard. It's been a little more of a slow burn. He continues to get better with each fight, and he could be one of the better fighters in the future of this lightweight division. And I'm really excited to see what he can do here on Saturday. I think it's going to be a good time. Love the bangers, Blake. Love the bangers. And let's talk about that main event, because before we give you our prediction here. So the most recent news, literally as we're recording this on, of course, the night before this releases, this is on Wednesday night. The UFC's right now is planning on going ahead with the 195 catch weight fight between Paulo Costa and Marvin Vettori, but nothing is concrete. Probably will be by when this drops. So let's see how things change there. But Paulo Costa on media day on Wednesday came out and said, I'm 200. Well, earlier, Marvin Vettori is like, yeah, he's not making weight. And then Paulo Costa comes out and says, I'm 212 pounds with 2 days to go in a weight cut where I need to get down to 185. I'm not making it. But I hated how nonchalant about this. It looked like he didn't really give a damn. I remember that Paul Felder interview about a year ago about how he stepped in really short notice against Dos Santos, and he was killing himself the night before to make 156 pounds, wasn't doing any training, and he still showed up and went out for 25 minutes. It's yep. a joke that these guys, a main event, you're trying to get back into title contention, and you're overweight by, what is that, 25 pounds? What?
Yeah, it's
that doesn't make sense to me, Blake.
You know, it's actually, to be completely exact, 27, but.
Are you really doing the math?
I mean, let's just be exact.
I hate you. Go ahead with your point. I mean,
if we want to be really exact, it's 26, since 186 is the limit.
Oh, you're.
But you know, I digress.
Fine. What's your point here?
My point is, I completely 100% agree with you. I think yep. Paulo Costa is a fat boy.
Who is that? Is he called an inflated balloon animal? He's not inflated just on steroids. He's also just fat. That's why. Marvin Vettori, do you think he kind of spiked his camp? Gave him a little. I mean, the Italians are known for two things besides a couple of very fantastic farms in the Benelli and in Berettas. But wine and pasta.
Pasta.
Two very filling things. And at least with the wine, we all know Paulo Costa loves that.
We all know he's a fan of the wine.
He's a fan of the wine, especially on fight night. Or the fight night eve. Is what
fight,
we call it.
Fight day morning.
Fight day morning / fight naive. Way too soon before a fight. I mean, who knows? Maybe Marvin Tori's been sinking some pasta over there. Some very nice wine, you know. Get him a little fat so he can't make weight here.
Get 30% of the purse, you know.
Is that the plan?
Could be.
It's dumb how he was like, he's missing out this weight. But then he goes and tried to put the blame on Vettori. Like, yeah, I want to do this. And it's up to him to take this fight. No, it's not Vittori's problem, man. It's not. Vittori, honestly, Vettori should even agree to this 195 pound. He shouldn't.
It's disgusting. Paulo Costa's made some really, really weird choices as of late. Mm-hmm. And this is just another one in the string of really dumb and weird choices he's made. If he keeps acting like this, he'll find himself in Bellator 1 really, really quickly.
It's at least in the light heavyweight division, so Yair Prochazka could take his head off. That fight wouldn't be close.
No. I mean, look at his little T-Rex arms, dude.
It's too big in the biceps, man. The biceps, they just get in the way.
That's why he
can't protect his head that much because, you know, he tries to bend the arms to cover up, and the biceps are just too big, man. His arms are like a foot in front of his face.
Maybe that's why he's getting fat, though, so it gets a little squishier. You know, lose a little muscle mass and replace it with some fat, and it squishes in a little bit.
It's so disappointing, man. But prediction time. Assuming 195-pound fight, who wins this one and how?
Man, I think Vittori's going to go in there and dominate. I just think he's got more of a dog in him.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's actually more technical as well.
Yes.
And I think he utilizes the full game plan, like the full kind of tool belt, I guess you could
distance,
say.
The clinch.
That he has. Ground game. Yeah, he'll string together the takedowns. He'll use his striking. He tries to strike with Adesanya, not very effectively, but he tries.
But not many people can.
Exactly. So, I mean, I think the dude is just an all-around, complete, fantastic, really, really, really good fighter, mm-hmm. just not on, you know, the best of all times level.
That's not a knock. I don't think that's not a knock, at least.
And so Costa, with him missing weight, that's not a good look. Mm-mm. That makes me question his cardio.
Mm-hmm.
It also
which was already not that great,
right? And in my opinion, I'm already questioning his mentality because it just seems like his actions and his words just...
He sounds like a quitter, man.
It's just not a good look, everything he's doing. I don't know. I definitely do know one thing. I am taking Vettori to win this via a 5-round decision beatdown.
Hey, give me Vettori. Tapping out Paulo Costa. Tapping out the Bloom boy.
Get him tired, rear neck and choke. Were you going to get specific or what are you thinking?
Yeah, I was thinking... He's just going to get he's going to get his back rear naked, done and good, and he's just going.
You gonna give a round or what?
Round three, third round, rear naked choke, Marvin Vettori.
Pretty quick fight, pretty quick fight.
If I'm right about this, I am going to go buy a lottery ticket so I can lose on that.
You better go download DraftKings and put some money on it.
Ooh, or yeah, we could do that. We could do that. You're right. All I know is I just hope Paulo Costa gets his ass whooped. I think that's the end of the story, right?
Kind of deserves it.
Kinda? No, he just deserves it.
He kind of deserves it.
I want his ass. I
You want his ass, bro? Come on, Aljamain.
Give me that.
Settle down.
Give me that. Coming for that. Call me easy, man. I'm going in the back.
Oh, you're getting nay-nay. You're getting nay-nay.
Oh, boy. But speaking of the nay-nay, Blake, wait to bring that up because that's what we're going to hop into to cap things off here, the nay-nay of the week. It's not me.
Should be.
It should be, but it's not. I determined the nay-nay, and I determined that the nay-nay is not me.
It should be you because the Broncos lost. The Broncos sucked. Raiders the best.
I was waiting an hour for that to come out, and it finally did. Congrats, Blake.
I've been holding that in. My forehead has been popping out.
I hate you so much. Oh, but the nay-nay of the week is anytime it's a DJ for any party that Conor McGregor is at, because you best know if Conor McGregor is there and you're the one on spinning the records there, don't play the wrong music because you're going to wind up with a broken nose. Conor McGregor takes out old men. He takes out himself. He takes out DJs now. And dude. Oh, man.
You better play the right songs and you better take a shot of his whiskey and not talk shit.
Who do you, what you think is, what kind of song would piss Conor off? What kind of song do you think the DJ was playing for him to deserve a broken nose?
Did the full story of that come out yet? I haven't really been keeping up with
probably, it. Probably, but I haven't been. I saw the headlines. I thought it was funny and stupid at the same time, and I kind of moved on.
Yeah.
Same thing with these Conor stories. It's all the same.
Well, I feel like it's hard to give Conor the benefit of the doubt, but there had to have been something else going on. If the guy was partying with them all night, he probably said something stupid.
I guess,
probably did
man.
Something stupid. Or maybe Conor just really is that crazy and lost his shit again. I mean, wouldn't surprise me. Wouldn't surprise me at all.
But, everything seems possible.
This type of music that would piss Conor off? I don't know, because he seems like...
Leprechaun music?
He seems like he's pretty into like rap music, stuff like that. I've seen a couple clips of him gigging to that.
Yeah. You think he's playing country?
What would he not like? I feel like he'd like classic because, you know, he's rich. And
he's a lavish man.
Put that on, you know, when he's getting into his Louis Vuitton robe for a shower.
On his yacht.
What would he not like, man? I don't know. This is a tough question.
Darius Rucker.
What is that?
Country.
Oh, yeah. He probably would. I don't know, bro. I feel like Conor would either really like country or he would. Just absolutely fucking hate it.
I feel like Conor would... I don't think he'd like grunge rock. I think that he would probably not like that very much.
I think he'd be okay with it.
Really?
Hell yeah.
I'm not seeing it.
Do a little head... Because then he'd get in the mosh pit, bro. He'd be going crazy.
Does Conor listen to, you know, maybe a little Avenged Sevenfold? Ooh, give me that. Give me Conor McGregor coming out to Avenged Sevenfold.
Some Slipknot?
Ooh, Slipknot, not bad. Now, hey, we just want to go through my workout playlist.
Hey,
it's all headbangers, that's for sure.
Let's just take Conor McGregor to Aftershock next year.
So he could fight Nate Diaz.
Ha!
Yes!
You know what I mean, bro?
Give me the trilogy on stage. I'll bring the octagon somehow.
I'll set it up, dude.
Hey, I'll go buy some fancy.
I took a picture with Nate, bro. Nate knows me.
Technically, he knows of you. He probably forgot by now.
I tagged him in the photo. He's probably seen it a few times. It's a good photo.
It was a good photo, that's for sure. But ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for listening to episode 62 of UFC Talk. This is just a damn good time. And let us know what you think about all this. Do you think Norma Dumont deserves a title shot next? Who is your cool-to-hate fighter? And do you hate Paulo Costa? If not, why don't you? And what's wrong with you? You can find all of us.
Get some help.
Get some help. That's the only way to put it. Make sure to check out all of our MMA content over at thefourthlong.com/MMA. Check out those interviews. Like I said, Jared Melton, Remy Lawley. You want to hear what they have to say because they're going to be champions here very, very soon. You can go find that over at, once again, at thefourthlong.com/MMA. And last but not least, we want to give a huge shout out to our Patreon supporters. Of course, you become one for just starting at $1 a month. We're still on the road to get Blake Campbell his first paycheck. That's actually meaningful and not just a few bucks that I give him from what we've made. Because I feel like that's more of a spin in the face than anything. But you know. But you can do that by going over to patreon.com/fourthandlong. Like I said, for just
buy some merch, subscribe the channel.
Hey, buy some merch.
Freaking YouTube, Spotify, yes. All the shit.
Hey, come on.
Fuck around.
Come on. This clothing is a certified banger. It just is. And if you want to be a certified banger yourself, you gotta wear the clothing. Okay. So walk and label. Walk and label. It's good stuff there. But huge shout out to our Patreon supporters. Of course, for all your car collecting needs, go on to over to Instagram and follow at the Big Bat Box. Huge thank you to Ray Rodriguez. Shout out to Ryan Watson and Neil Wiley. And Blake, your thoughts on UFC Vegas 40 in one word or phrase?
Let the coaches coach. Ooh. How about that? Don't be crying on your couch. That's all I gotta say.
You couch coach, go.
Don't be crying. Coach. Just let them do the thing. If the fighter doesn't like the coach, they'll fire the coach. I guarantee you.
Yeah, straight up, Anthony. I mean,
that's it. And then also,
Waller was really good at that.
Another phrase I would say is just it's not a phrase that's been coined yet, but Jim Miller is badass.
Yeah, I think that's it. Jim Miller is a badass. We'll see you next week, ladies and gentlemen, on the road to UFC Vegas. Not even UFC Vegas anymore. UFC 267. It's going to be a damn good time. We'll see you next week.